Welcome, everybody. I saw a yawn. Now, hang on. This is Jolt of Energy number two, right? Short talks. You are here to hear Raj Jayadev, creating space for systems change. He is the co-founder of Silicon Valley Debug, a community organizing and advocacy organization. Since 2001, Debug has been a platform for Silicon Valley's diverse communities. They exist, right? And he's working with them, right?
Yep.
I just love that. Diverse communities in Silicon Valley. That is good. He has been a platform for Silicon Valley's diverse communities to impact the political, cultural, and social landscape of the region while also becoming a nationally recognized model for community-based justice work. And look at this. I mean, you got a full room here. This is great. So we have a lot to learn. Thank you all for being here. Through Debug, Jayadev and his colleagues also started a family organizing model called the Albert Covarrubias Justice Project, which we'll hear more about today. To expand and deepen his work, he is an Ashoka Fellow, Rosenberg Leading Edge Fellow, was a Stanford University social entrepreneur in residence. So you're in school a lot, yes? Yes. And a lot to teach us. We are very excited to have him here. Let's give him a warm welcome.
Okay, thanks everyone for having me this afternoon. It means a lot. And I apologize for the left side of the field. Can you all hear me at least?
Yes.
I don't make a very physically imposing figure. So the good thing is I brought slides, so you could look at photos of other folks from our organization. They wanted me to stand over here, so it's not some sort of bias. It's just I'm following directions of the conference. So thanks again for having me. Normally what would happen if I have an opportunity to talk to people, 100 people, 3 people on the walk up from where I park my car, I'd be telling them the origin story of participatory defense, a community organizing model that we develop for families to impact the outcome of cases of their loved ones and simultaneously transform the landscape of power in the courts. But given who you all are, I actually want to do something a little bit different. I'm still going to tell you about participatory defense, but I want to tell you the pre-origin story. And that's a conversation I usually don't get to have, and I'm excited because you are the group to have it with, quite frankly. To really name one central place to have a discussion later today, next week, what have you, which is, what is the environment of innovation that allows nonprofits to create systemic change that is even beyond their original imaginations? That to me is sort of the question. And I'm gonna talk about Debug and participatory defense, not because I think it's the sole shining example, but it's just an example that I know of and approximate to my life. It's proximate to this Bay Area, and I wanna tell how we create an environment for this thing to grow. So, this is a picture inside our community center. We're about, okay. Trying to see who's awake. if you blinked, you actually didn't miss anything. Bless you. But so this is our community center in San Jose. It's called Silicon Valley Debug. What you're looking at is actually the roots of our organization, what was described earlier about creating a platform for the unheard voices of Silicon Valley. So even though now organizationally we're thought of as a criminal justice organization in most circles, we didn't start in courtrooms, we started in assembly rooms, in factory shop floors, in warehouses, on the other side of Silicon Valley that most people don't talk about. When we started, the common denominator of those diverse communities that was described earlier is we were all doing temp work. We were all doing some form of assembly or warehouse work, janitorial or even receptionists, all the side of Silicon Valley that people don't talk about when they think of the engine of the new economy. But those communities existed. And so we wanted to create a public voice. And so we created a zine, a magazine, something that people could fold and keep in their pocket so the boss wouldn't see them when they're on the assembly line. They could pick it up at the lunch truck. If they're going to school, their teachers wouldn't yell at them. And how we produced that content is we sat in circles around a table and swap stories. And it was all predicated on this one simple principle. And that was that anyone, regardless of their station in life, regardless of their credentials, had the capacity to reflect on their lives, who they were, the world around them, and how they related to it. And in that process, we all became storytellers. And you could see the magazines on the back of the wall. That's sort of our archive. And in that way, the assembly worker became a journalist. And the reception worker that was switching temp agencies became a television producer for our local shows. And we grew our different media platforms to be that sort of megaphone for an experience in Silicon Valley that was not being talked about and had nowhere in the historical narrative of the valley. And so from a foundation perspective and from a nonprofit and our peers, we were put in the category of youth media because in a lot of ways that's what we were. We were creating opportunities for young people to be heard in a way that they weren't before. And it was developmental and it was transformative. And you could see these are all folks that otherwise were not supposed to have their own lane in Silicon Valley. To be not on the dot-com fast track in Silicon Valley, to work one of those jobs, to not have a public voice or a public space, meant that you were isolated and alone. And part of what youth media did, not just in our world, but in all kinds of different communities, is it created a collective, a communal out of what otherwise would have been a marginalized, isolated road. And so above the break of the water, we were seen as youth media and were evaluated as such. We're evaluated by the size and scope of our media product, our magazines, how wide the distribution was, how many contributors we had, maybe sometimes the themes of what we covered and the multimedia approaches that we had to it. But there's something else happening below the break of the water that I want to talk about. And happens in every single nonprofit, whether it's explicit or unidentifiable or not. And that while all that was going on, we were developing our own organizational philosophy. What Silicon Valley would say in their parlance, we were creating an operating system, a framework of thinking that would dictate and guide our decision-making points at the different forks in the roads of our life as a group. And as we got closer to one another, our questions then evolved from asking each other what story you want to write about at those meetings to what do you want to do. And we became very refined about intricacies of what those weekly meetings around a table would look like, intentionally sitting in circles so it didn't give authority to one person, rotating facilitators so it was clear that everyone had power and everyone could ask questions and offer information. And in that philosophy, we also gave ourselves the liberty to identify ourselves any which way we wanted to, which was the same freedom we were giving individuals in the group, which, by the way, is what Silicon Valley supposedly promised everyone, to define yourselves by your own terms. And we defined ourselves as the anti-organization, the unorganization, in the sense that in any group or organization or business or team, the idea is you leave your individual aspirations, your individual baggage, personal issues at the door for the good of that monolithic group mission statement, for the good of the collective, of the team. What we said was the exact opposite. What we said is you bring in everything of who you are, all your personal issues, all your baggage, supposedly, and also those audacious dreams and ideas that you had that you thought no one else would support. And then you lead us, and we will follow you. And in that way, we started looking a lot different based on what was peeking out the water. So we had a magazine, but then some people wanted to do television. We had a television show. Some folks wanted to do meditation, so we started meditation circles. The undocumented immigrants that didn't have an access to or toehold in the economy wanted to start entrepreneurial projects, so we developed a music studio downstairs, and a t-shirt making company downstairs. We made a bike company. And it looked like all these disparate, different activities that had no connective tissue at all. But on the inside looking out, it made perfect sense. because those were all extensions of our operating system. We saw ourselves as a sangha, which is a Buddhist concept. And Buddha said that on the path of liberation, you need the eyes to see the path, the legs to walk it, and a sangha. And as organizers, we saw eyes as theory. We needed organizational theory. And legs as practice. We needed the discipline to actually act upon it. And we needed a sangha. And sangha is a Pali word. It doesn't exist anymore. But the term means a community of practitioners who are all seeking their own liberation. And we thought, that's what we're doing. And so we would have folks that came to that meeting, that community space, because they wanted a toehold in an economy that said they should not exist. They came to those meetings because they had a substance abuse they're trying to overcome. They came to those meetings because the world saw them as one thing, but they saw themselves as an artist, as a poet, as a writer. We took the term debug, and that term doesn't even exist in the Bay Area anymore. It's offshored. But back then, the jobs we work, like let's say this is an assembly line, and we all work these jobs at some point. If your product doesn't work at the end of the assembly line, you call the debug unit to inspect the product and get to the root cause of the malfunction and expose it. We thought, that's what we're trying to do. And so this is all what was developing without any clear articulation, but this is the family. And so while all this was going on, though, we were not existing in a vacuum. There was a world around us. And so when young people would, say, be coming to debug to those weekly meetings or to use the music studio, things would happen. The world would interact with them. And so that often meant that they were getting police contact. So like Rudy, who's defined as being developmentally delayed, that's him at 17 with his mother. He was wrongfully charged for the crime he did not commit. And he came to the place where he goes to in crisis, which is his local nonprofit, which is part of his life, debug. But we thought, we're not lawyers. We're not a criminal justice organization. This is not our arena to make change. What can we do, right? There's nothing in our grant, nothing in our mission statement that said what to do in this moment. So we relied on our operating system. We took the same disciplines and tendencies that we used and cultivated over the years to apply in this new moment of crisis for one of our members that we cared about. And so what it looked like was very similar. It meant that we were going to come together as a group and meet with the same regularity and discipline as we did those weekly editorial meetings, rain or shine. It meant that we were going to take an isolated experience and collectivize it, democratize it, make it so it's a group experience rather than a solitary one. So you see Rudy at the end of the table with his mother Blanca in the front. This is one of the meetings that became known as participatory defense. It meant that we were going to sit in a circle. It meant that we were going to rotate facilitators. And just that same irreverence that we allowed ourselves that said assembly workers can be journalists, we have that same irreverence to say a mother can be an agent of change in a courtroom despite not being a lawyer or a judge. And that collectively we would problem solve to try to free folks like Rudy, like Gail's sons Kareem, like Lamar, like Cecilia and her father. And we could do it collectively because the tenet of organizing says we're stronger together than we are alone. And we started seeing tangible impacts. Charges getting dismissed, sentence reductions, acquittals at trial. We saw the group developing new practices, expressions of the operating system. So they started creating mechanics that would help them review police reports, pointing out inconsistencies of officers. They would go to court with one another so they weren't alone and they'd have a group presence. They would create ways to tell the fuller truth of their loved one. And so when we would come up through the experience, we would find ways that were learning opportunities of what would our operating system instruct us to do. So after going to a bunch of sentencing hearings, walking back to the parking lot, the most common refrain we would hear wasn't, man, I hate that prosecutor, or that judge got it all wrong. I wish I had a better defense attorney. the most common refrain that we would hear in the courtroom parking lot was, "I wish they knew them like we know them." That's what they would say. And so that instructed us to rely on our media capacities to then answer that call. And so we started making a tool that's now nationally popularized, for a better word, better lack of a better term, called social biography packets, which are these packets that tell a court who a person is beyond a case file. And one of the first people that did it was Carnell. No instruction manual, no go-to plan, no app that would do it for him. And he came to us because he had a low-level drug charge, but was facing a 5-year prison sentence because of California's messed up sentencing laws. That's another conversation. Get at me after the talk. But he hadn't been sentenced yet. And he came to every meeting with his daughters. And we knew him principally not as someone that was defined in his case file. We knew him as a father. And so we gave him a camera, and we said, take pictures of what it's like being a dad, like the way we would when we do photo essays for the magazine, which were experience-based. And he took pictures of making the girls breakfast and taking them to school, taking them after-school programs, doing homework. And it became this photo essay in a binder. And he gave it to his public defender, who then used at the sentencing hearing. And that judge, who formally had indicated a minimum of a 5-year prison sentence, turned that into a 6-month outpatient drug program. Because he understood Carnell in this whole different light because of the storytelling truth of the media. And when families started doing this, we thought, well, we also have other media chops. What if we connected the skill set of the videographers in the group that, again, didn't go to school for it, but learned on the way? What if we connected those storytelling capacities to our cases as well? And so we started making social biography videos, which would be 10-minute videos that were submitted to a prosecutor through an attorney during negotiation or a sentencing, and they worked as magically as the packets did because it broke the sterility of the court and created a whole new level of understanding outside of what a judge normally would understand. And I think is now the future of mitigation in the American judicial system. That's us working on a commutation that's happening right now. So the question for us too then was, well, how do we measure this work as organizers? And I don't say measure it because we had a grant report to submit. This thing did not exist on the books at all. Some folks in the room know our origins. We were mainly thought of as another type of organization. But we needed to measure the work to prove it to the community that it was possible. We couldn't just tell the story of Carnell and Ramon and Rudy. And so we came up with a metric called time saved. And it's a play on the term that the system uses. And we still say it in our weekly meetings all across the country, where someone comes into our weekly meetings and it's the most anxiety-filled moment of their lives. They're not sure they have the capacity to do anything. They've been told that they don't have anything that they can do. And we say, look, if you sit on your hands, the system is going to give you a loved one time served. But if you engage, if you participate, if you lean on this sangha, you could turn time served into time saved. So Carnell, for example, would represent 5 years of time saved from incarceration. When we totaled the numbers based on all the families coming to those weekly meetings, just in San Jose after a couple years, we had 1,862 years of time saved from incarceration. And so we held a party. It was called the 1800 party. Wasn't a good name for a party, like in hindsight, but people got to expand the sangha. And the other form of measurement, though, that organizers use, and I'm not saying, I don't know how it translates in terms of philanthropy, but I guess that's your job. which is, an organizer's measuring stick is also, how does an experience transform someone's sense of power? That's it. That's it. And it may not even be reflected in the case outcomes, right? They may not always be Carnell or Ramones or these other kind of amazing stories. And so can you develop a practice that is designed and intended to strip someone of power and agency and have it do the absolute opposite? Criminal justice system breaks people. Can we create an organizing model that makes families and individuals feel more empowered despite the designs of the criminal justice system? And it worked to the level where people wanted to move beyond just case outcomes. They wanted to make systemic change based on the patterns that they're seeing through their own families' experiences. And so those families that you saw around that red table started employing collective organizing power to make systemic change. And here's the one thing that we learned along the road. A system that has been immune or insulated from the power of community organizing, when you add a drop of it, it can change things dramatically. And so those same organizations, no law degrees, no policy degrees, no identified political stature, stopped ICE from coming into our county jails, the first county in the country to do that. Created a blueprint for bail reform that is being mirrored and looked at nationally, stopped juveniles from being directly prosecuted as adults. That's Veronica. Her son Christian was one of the test cases that was used. And when I mean they were involved, I don't mean just holding the signs at the rallies. I mean she was on those late night calls that became ultimately the law that is changing the future in people's lives. So the other test, though, for an organizer is the opposite of almost every other profession that I know of, in that what you use to show acumen in other professions is to show that you're exceptional, to show you are the best, you are uniquely gifted. In organizing, you show the opposite. Your acumen is tested by how well others can do exactly what you do. And so we started sharing the model nationally. And this is in places like, these are weekly meetings in Nashville, Knoxville. This is some of our folks doing a webinar for Philadelphia, which is going to be our new kind of juvenile blueprint city. This is actually down the street at Google. We brought 30 city organizations from different cities together to do a boot camp on social bio training down the street. And when we would go to a city and we would kind of share the stories, what we'd ask is, how many of y'all, and I don't mean just like criminal justice organizations, I mean any community touchstones in a city that wants to do more when a member or constituent's arrested. We say, how many of you have a fire extinguisher in your building? And most of the hands would go up. And we say, why do you have a fire extinguisher? And they say, so we would be ready to protect our people if a fire hits. So what do you do if there's a looming incarceration? And no one had the break glass fire extinguisher toolkit. And we said participatory defense could be that. And then we had some of these cities that said, look, I have a fire burning in my community every day. I don't need a fire extinguisher. I need to build a fire station. I need to do what you all are doing in San Jose. And so we would do these extensive trainings with them where they would learn how to become a participatory defense hub and do exactly the thing that the families were doing in the other parts of the city. We now have 21 participatory defense hubs across the country. I mean, every night of the week, there's a circle of families meeting. They're working on social bio packets and videos. They're deconstructing police reports. They're challenging prosecutors, sometimes defense attorneys that are slow to the game. They've collected, as of the beginning of 2018, 4,218 years of time saved from incarceration. I'm going to close with this. I bring that up not to say, look at this amazing organization. I say that because all that changed and all that was possible through people sitting around that red table. And there was nothing magical in the water of San Jose that allowed that to happen. All it was an organization that was given the time and space to reflect on, interrogate, and then articulate what our operating system is. And if I had one request then, and this is where every kind of talk to funders probably concludes in this way, why multi-year, non-restricted grant funding is important. But here's what they don't tell you. The reason why that is important is because it allows you to think about what your operating system is. Because the sands shift below you, the programs differ, the needs to respond in the communities differ. But if you have a clear understanding of your operating system, of your philosophy, you could turn an instinct into a practice that could not only change just systems, but could change the course of history. Thank you.